Today is the first Sunday of Lent. Welcome. Let us pray. Almighty God, whose Son Jesus Christ fasted 40 days in the wilderness and was tempted as we are, yet without sin, give us grace to discipline ourselves in obedience to your Spirit. And as you know our weakness, so may we know your power to save. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our gospel reading comes from Mark chapter 1, beginning to read at verse 9. In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart, and the Spirit descending like a dove on him, and a voice from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." And the Spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness. He was in the wilderness 40 days, tempted by Satan, and he was with the wild beasts, and the angels waited on him. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." The word of the Lord. Jesus was tempted, and his temptations were real, just as yours and my temptations are real. Like so many temptations, they occurred when he was alone, for temptation is often a lonely encounter. Perhaps we can learn from the temptations that Jesus faced so that we can deal more effectively with our own temptations and struggles. The first temptation of Jesus was to convert stones into bread. There is always a temptation to convert stones into the bread of life, to convert material possessions into the primary sources of satisfaction. The fundamental deceit is that if I have a little more money, a little more material pleasures, then I will be happier. That is an illusion, a fantasy. The second temptation for Jesus was that he was taken up to the top of a temple at Jerusalem, some 150 feet high, and told to throw himself down, and God's hands and the angels in heaven would catch him before he splattered on the earth. One of the greatest temptations of life is to want God to prove himself to us, like, "Show me a miracle, then I will believe and follow you." Then there was a third temptation. Jesus was taken up to Mount Hermon, that was nearly 10,000 feet high, and asked to worship the devil in order to inherit the world. Here was a temptation that is at the root of so many other temptations. The temptation is the pursuit of glory, status, power, self-importance, self-gratification. The devil tempted Jesus, and he tempts us in the same ways. For 40 days, Jesus experienced a tug of war, the devil tempting him and the angels serving him. Today, we are reminded of the resources that Jesus used to resist temptation, and you and I are wise to use the same resources. Let us take a closer look at these resources. Firstly, we need to be filled with the Spirit of the living God, which helps us to withstand temptations from within and without. The Spirit is connected with prayer. The life of Jesus was infused by the power of God through prayer. Our days should begin and end with prayer. and so should feel so many moments in between. We, God's people, are meant to be in constant conversation with God, and this gives us a spiritual power to stand against the schemes of the devil. Secondly, Jesus always encountered the temptations of the devil by quoting a Bible verse from Scripture. Jesus knew that God was stronger than any temptation you would encounter, and he used the weapons of the Spirit. He quoted the Scriptures three times. First, he said, "You shall not live by bread alone." Secondly, "You shall worship only the Lord your God and serve him." Thirdly, "You shall not put the Lord God to you the test." For the Bible to have power, it needs to live inside of you so that it can become a sword in the spirit of the Spirit and useful to you. To walk in that wilderness, to be alone with God, feeds your soul. For each encounter with God changes you forever, just as it changed Moses when he encountered God in the burning bush. So each encounter changes us. For in the wilderness, you cannot escape from who you are, nor can you escape from the one who calls you to be so much more than just who you are. In the wilderness, you are laid bare and open to all things that God calls you to be. So I do not think that it is coincidental that Jesus is led into the wilderness by the Spirit. Jesus is led to discover who he is. In the wilderness, we become more aware of our dependence on God. In the wilderness, we learn to trust God's ways of being. In the wilderness, we are connected to what God is doing in the world. In the wilderness, when all else is taken away, we learn the ultimate value of love. For Jesus leads the way, and we are called to follow. Surely we too will be tempted. Surely we too will be led to the wilderness and confronted with our true selves. But when we arrive, we find that Jesus has already been there, transforming our deserts into the oasis of God's love and the vision of God's future. In Jesus, we have God's forgiveness. He calls us into the wilderness today to meet with God face to face and to come to know the depth of God's love. Amen. Let us pray. O God, you created us in your image, giving us the gift of life. Help us to turn our eyes and see the reflection of Christ in the eyes of everyone who is participating in your kingdom on this earth. We thank you for the gift of the Holy Spirit that lives in each one of us and enables us to share love, to share concern, to share service, to be disciples. Bless us on this day and every day that opens before us with the opportunity to be like Jesus, to make a difference in the world that you have shared with us. In our wilderness, help us to experience your presence. Help us to know that we too are attended to by angels and that we can come out of the wilderness into the world and make a difference in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless.